More Mac and Me. I'm excited. I think we're going to see strange things today. Not sure. Just have a feeling. I wanted to do a little bit of a recap. So I was thinking a little bit more about some of the preceding scenes and so on. I guess the first thing I want to talk about is this section here where Mac is rearranging the house. We have all that dialogue when they move into the house about how the house has been really optimized for Eric's disability so that he never has to be uncomfortable, essentially. You know, it's that part where his mom is saying how the hallways are extra wide and the windows are all low and the shelving is all low and just basically all of these amenities in this place that have that are going to, you know, accommodate a kid in a wheelchair. And Eric seems very happy about the house, you know? Then there's that whole weird interlude with the television set. Then Mac does this. He destroys the house. So evidently Mac isn't happy with it. But if Mac represents Eric's unconscious, you see, that's very, very interesting. Because it is as if the unconscious craves growth and, in a way, danger and risk and experience. That's that Erosian sort of blood, sex, danger, adrenaline, sort of passion of life kind of energy that connects us to the earth, which is what Mac has made central in his redecoration of the home. And interesting, isn't it, that Mac has provided a body to a head that was disconnected. Perhaps like a disconnected logos or left hemisphere. It's to be grounded back into the natural world. I really do love that we have this red hat here, and just the expression on this thing is amusing to me. I think we really can read this in that way because, I mean, just look at how this stuff is aligned in the timeline here. It's just right after this house decoration thing, Eric wanders out into the garden. You see, the garden is protected. It's just like the home. In the home, everything is safe and controlled. And Eric, who is, you know, a boy who is disabled and whose mother has to sort of literally hover around his back and take him everywhere and be with him all the time, the garden of safety and the mother and the house are all very tightly networked there, I think, in the meaning of this story. Because here, the wilderness is beckoning Eric. That extroverted, active, adventurous energy is pulling him to leave the safety of that house and to leave the safety of that garden. And like Mac has suggested, right? Just like Mac suggested with his conversion of the home into the natural world, Eric is going to set out, precisely into the wild. Note, of course, that this is also a psychological metaphor. The wild is the unconscious, and Mac is the psychopomp. In a way, Mac functions as the anima here, I think. And in a way, we have a confirmation of that in the fact that the female child we see interacting most often with Eric, was her name Debbie, is herself some kind of a medium, right? Who communicates with the earth spirits. So those are almost like two reflections of Eric's anima. I think that Mac and I hope it's Debbie are quite interrelated in that sense. So much of these, are they roses or are they just red petals of some sort? It's almost like she's looking at them here. Now, here's what I would also say. It's funny. I was just talking with Alan Waller about the notion of the double anima. This goes to the idea of Kali and Parvati. There's a kind of a dark anima and a light anima, perhaps. And so if the light anima is Debbie, who is... I think she's very worried here and trying to help Eric not die, you know, which is basically Parvati's role. She takes care of Shiva. Soothes him and calms him and so on. Kali, meanwhile, excites Shiva's bloodlust. and his, you know, it's exactly like Mac in a way. Mac wrecked the house, you know, and now Mac is causing Eric to do something very foolish and dangerous and kind of, you know, okay, he's taken a serious leap of faith in the initiatory sense, but also in the literal sense here, this is a kid who could, well, you know, in the literal space of the story, I mean, a kid who could die. So I do feel in a way that that makes Mac like Kali. you know, maybe it really is that I just need to see Kali everywhere all the time. I have no idea. But I think in some way, Mac really is like a darker, or let's say a kind of chaotic, neutral a dangerous sort of anima. Anima in the sense of, or not in the sense, but let's say here, anima conceived of as a psychopomp figure, leading the ego deeper into the labyrinth, into the unconscious. Facial articulation on that thing. Interesting that the, you know, the perhaps sort of the thonic psychopomp, which is, Mac is very feral, you know, he doesn't speak English and he communicates primarily with images, you know, he selects images and sends them to television sets and then he cuts out things from magazines and newspapers. Also kind of like an artist, you know, because he like redecorates the house and all of this. So yeah, I feel pretty confident really in saying that he's a somewhere in the domain of a thonic anima psychopomp figure, taking the psychological read here. In any case, I think that's all pretty interesting and strange, you know, to see in a film that is basically a McDonald's commercial. Like, you know, like what is all this weird stuff doing in here about a child who is very dependent on his mother, whose father is absent and who is crippled, who then has an unconscious, let's sort of run with the read here. Say Mac represents the unconscious and this particular aspect of the unconscious that is trying to pull the ego into a conversation with it, essentially. Something to do perhaps with the transcendent function, which makes sense then given this immersion in the pool and all the subsequent rebirth scenes that we see later. You know, all of that material Oh, I'm sorry. A bird just flew by in my window. It was very majestic and distracted me. And now I've really lost my train of thought. What were we talking about here? I was just trying to kind of wrap up this section. To say about this, really. I would suppose that a lot of this structure is lifted out of, like we were saying last time, is basically just lifted out of ET. You just copy ET stuff into here, and ET is a pretty sophisticated movie. It too has a particular kind of family situation involving a dad in Mexico and an alien that is definitely representing the unconscious in some kind of interesting way, I think. And so we see that stuff kind of copied here, but it's copied very poorly, you know? It's as if in the poorness of the copying, that has allowed it to be more accurate. So E.T. is fascinating, but a little bit more ambiguous. This seems so kind of clear-cut to me, the way it's all working. It's like Eric really is the ego, and he has to separate from the... maybe it isn't that clear-cut, because it's, you know, the immersion into the water is like the immersion into Mother Nature, which is like the immersion into the unconscious. So that all stacks up there. But that, you see, in the context of the individuation myth, is about an adult ego, really a kind of second half of life ego. Like Jung imagines it as a post-30s ego, who has already been fully separated from the mother. The mother considered here, you know, in the archetypal sense, not necessarily the literal mother, although that's involved as well often, but more in the sense of really, in the end, I would say, in the sense of leaving right hemispheric operation and moving into a particular sort of left hemispheric operation, which is much more externally oriented, because in the first half of life, it's about establishing external structure and just learning how to exist in the physical world. And then in the later half of life, there's a need to return to right hemispheric operation to work on internal issues. Basically, because in the first half of life, doing all this external stuff in the external world, the internal world is becoming rather discombobulated and pushed around because all kinds of traumatic things are happening. And so strange splits and subpersonalities and complexes and things are developing in there. And that's all happening below the surface for most people. If there's a psychotic break, that stuff can become kind of visualized and simulated and externalized, say, in really strange art and things like that. But typically it's happening kind of more on the inside, and then what you see on the outside are just neuroses and bad behaviors, and then sometimes people snap and they murder their family or terrible things happen. But those situations had been bubbling up in here over, you know, very many years. And so if you want to avoid these kinds of eventualities, you might want to take a dive back in there at some point and start fixing the garden. What's strange about this narrative, I think, is that it's kind of juxtaposing the two halves of life on top of each other, you know? Because on the one hand, there seems to be a clear individuation story here about the ego leaving its protected garden of consciousness, basically, and returning to nature. You know, rebuilding the body to attach to the head, like Mac does, which broadly tracks this sort of the second half of life individuation idea. You know, we leave the garden, we follow the unconscious, we follow the psychopomp into the unconscious, where a transformation happens and it's a big rebirth, and it involves learning how to speak to the unconscious in pictures, and all these interesting things happen. So it's very much that sort of an individuation story, I think. But then at the same time, it's a story about a child. It's not an adult. It's a child who needs to separate from his mother but can't because of a physical disability. So that's a different context there. Not sure exactly how to relate all that, but I do want to say something about it. I wonder if there isn't a sense in which the ego of the modern individual hasn't somehow become rather more childlike. I think the ego is always kind of childish in its undeveloped state, i.e. its pre-individuated state. It's a little weird to draw those lines because it's like, what does pre-individuated mean? Like, we're always individuating. It's this infinite sort of spiral process. That's a funny thing to erupt there. I also think there is a very valid distinction to be made between egos that have no awareness whatsoever of the unconscious and egos that do. That's a pretty big shift once that's happened. And that's really a big shift because the experience that you'll go through to get from one side of that to the other is, once you have that awareness of the unconscious, it's no longer possible for the ego to remain so childlike. It is, in a way, the same thing as becoming spiritually mature, let's say, because it involves sort of the next tier of realism in your model, in the ego's model of itself. Now the ego sees that it is merely a part. Previously thought, I'm the ego, and I'm driving this thing called my body, which, you know, has some various components in it, etc. But now it sees, oh, actually, I'm this weird thing in this giant thing called a human being that I don't know what it is, because that's a transcendental externality. I can't really see what the complete human being is. I'm just this weird little perceiving node in it. And there's all this other unconscious stuff, and then that's sort of surrounding me like an ocean. That's a very different self-image, a critically different self-image. And at least for me, it's been a critically different self-image. Now the ego knows something about itself that's very important, which is that it has to interface and get along with all these other strange things that it coexists with in its psychological environment. Gosh, Mac and me got really heavy really fast this time. Let's advance the clip a little bit here. So I was in the middle of sort of trying to conclude this little section before we advance in the film. Why might the modern ego be comparatively more childlike? Perhaps that would make its individuation more difficult, because one imagines, okay, it's even less developed than usual. It's an ego that isn't even really adult yet. It's an ego that's simply much less mature. But that lack of maturity also could potentially bring with it a naivety of perception, which might allow synchronistic phenomena to be seen. Perhaps egos that are more traumatized become more adult, you know, rather what we consider to be adult. But maybe what we consider to be adult is in some way actually just about very sad adjustments to trauma that don't actually fix any of the underlying issues. Perhaps the modern ego isn't childish in the sense of give me, give me, give me, take care of all my needs. Although maybe that's also an aspect of it. Maybe that's sort of the negative aspect of it. But then the positive aspect of that childishness is that it makes it proximate to the divine child. And the divine child has a sort of a clear and radiant beginner's mind that can notice all kinds of funny details in pictures and other places that might serve to individuate it. You know, if indeed that's the situation that's going on. I think it's, in some weird way, I'm trying to kind of relate Mac and me's story to millennial psychology or something. Sometimes it just goes that way, guys. What can I say? Let's move forward. Okay. That's what I get for making a Mac and Me video directly after like a 4-hour conversation with Alan. We always get really deep into psychology. And then I've got all that stuff on my mind. Here now I need to start shifting my focus of attention towards the images again. Just, you know, a perfect sort of double red helmet thing. Blue car. Red boat plane stretcher thing. 727413. Okay, these two. The dog runs by. Huh. This is strange. You know, I really think, you know, I'm sorry, but that's bizarre. Like, red and blue on some level is a motif in this film, consciously put in this film. I'm pretty confident saying that. You know, it's just too much with that. You know, we skipped ahead at one point and looked at that weird Wix furniture thing that Mac does red and blue as well. Like, it's just all over the place. Here they pass by the... Is this child holding a dog? The one in the red vehicle, which is hovering around two cop cars with antennas. Wow, look at that. They keep the line running back there. It's very precisely edited. That's impressive and strange. Two figures in hats. Antenna. Strong blue element. Numbers here, interesting, 26. White and black vehicle. Debbie sits here, mother. Pen, book. Interesting logos here. Here goes the Atomic Kid. God, you know, that is such a perfect match to that particular, like, aspect of the vector. Fuck. Because this is exactly what we said about it. It's a kid, and it's a vehicle, like a red vehicle, like an exploding vehicle, and it's a dog, like a weird little animal. It all is right there. Next to the fire truck. Here the redhead goes by. What is she saying? Oh, well. I don't know what that's of. It just kind of looked to me like a face there, maybe. I'm sure I'm wrong about that. Dinosaurs of a car, books. Here you have kind of a whale suspended by a bunch of balloons. There are two red balloons prominently there. Kind of looked at this before. I really wonder what that's from. It looks like some specific thing. Like, are these characters we could recognize, maybe? It does seem to make Eric pretty North Tower-y by giving him an antenna like that. There's this funny bear. This image sits there.
Won't you follow this with your eyes? Good.
Interesting, kind of like a POV shot here. How ridiculous is this? This kid just, like, deliberately drove himself off a cliff, and they bring in a physician to, like, shine a light in his eyes. basically do a very like basic physical examination. When what ought to happen is a psychological examination.
Could you leave this alone for a minute?
Maybe I've misread this, though. I forget how this part plays out. This is like a yellow truck and a red truck or car and ships, boats.
Your mother tells me that you've been seeing some things.
Weird thing again.
You are believing. Try me.
We'll always say that, but they really rarely do believe it, you know?
It's a little creature. Do you see him often? Just the things that he does.
Interesting. Mac isn't seen directly, but just his actions are observed.
I'm gonna give you this mild sedative.
I'm just gonna give him a sedative. God.
What?
That's really funny. Now, Eric is making actually a very important point here, a very valid point, because basically this guy's saying, yeah, that sounds like you're pretty much having some kind of a bad experience. Let's just give you a sedative. And Eric's saying, no, this is something that really happened to me. And ask this other person. And well, yeah, indeed, that's how we figure out what reality is. We have many perceiving agents existing in consensus around something in the middle that they can form some agreement on as they talk to each other. That's basically how we define consensus reality and how we define sanity. But so here's the thing about that is people like this doctor, this pretend doctor, this pretend movie, have never left the garden. You see, Eric stepped outside of the garden of, I was saying before, of consciousness. Let's now say the garden of sanity. You can't know anything about sanity, really, until you've stepped outside of it. Then you can see it from outside a little bit and understand what sanity is. But what you start to realize is that sanity and insanity are actually kind of weird symmetrical reflections, and it's very difficult to tell them apart. Anyway. Don't take this. I remember, does Eric actually take these pills, or does he figure out a way to avoid the brutal tyranny of this supposed healer? My guess is trying his best. I don't know. Off he goes, and in comes Debbie? Is that right? Right, so Eric does not partake sedative. So that's at least the second time we've heard Mac referred to as a ghost in this film. This is in such close alignment to the head here that it's hard for me not to read that as somehow something significant happening. I just don't really get this collection of objects over here at the moment. Whales afloat. I guess it is water energy. It's a fish. We did hear about tuna on whole wheat. potentially kind of read that in a certain way. I'm going to leave that alone for now, actually. Stuff like this is interesting to me because on the one hand, this is just a very predictable, stupid trope, you know? It's just like how many movies exist where there's this thing like the kids can see the magic and the adults just don't get it, you know? Like it's like this terrible like template sort of approach to making a movie. But on the other hand, I really believe in the truth of that story as a little parable about, or you know, that type of story as a parable about psychology. You know, like we were saying before, I really think that learning to see with the eyes of the child as an adult, or managing to preserve it through into adulthood, Sync is somehow about that. It's certainly about reconnecting to a sense of wonder. That's pretty clear. It is in some strange way about unlearning the limits that language has placed onto our pictures. It's about getting back to the primacy, but fundamentally the ambiguity of the image. And images carry many paradoxical meanings simultaneously. I want to open up a can of worms about symbolism now, but let's not. the perception of sync. Yields this very transformation because it's like first you just see the dead tropes. Once the sync transition has occurred, whatever that is, you might find yourself thinking, oh wow, what looked like a dead cliche before is actually this perfect little descriptor of this very real process that happened somewhere very deep within me that did birth a divine child of some sort. All right, so she works at McDonald's, so that's how we gain access to that incredibly bizarre and hilarious and terrible McDonald's dance scene. I talked over it, but they have some kind of code to talk about math, I guess. I'm pretty interested in the way the shadows fall on the door here. Just even compositionally, you know, but it's an interesting shot. Some attempt to have like a teenage romance subplot here. I don't remember if there's really any significant character development or anything that happens between these two, or if it just kind of stays at this level of non-vent. It does rather feel to me like attempts to sort of shoehorn in like, oh, we can get like a slightly older demographic of kid and make them eat McDonald's and drink Coke as well. I don't know. He reaches, Silvestri reaches for that theme. Da, na, 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 every time we see this fan. Really is like some weird Back to the Future van leitmotif, you guys. What the fuck is Silvestri doing? bizarre. I just can't get enough of these blinds. It's, I know maybe it's not that unusual, but I think it's hilarious though. What was it with the 1980s and blinds? Doubled up there. Right. So here we're gonna drop mom off at her new job. That situation eventually yields a very impressive tableau, which I don't remember precisely where that occurs in time. It's not for Waze, I guess. Because it happens after the McDonald's scene. Oh gosh, I think we're missing potentially critical images here. Let's back up. Wow, there's vacuuming happening out there somehow. It's kind of funny though, because isn't there a vacuum coming up in this movie? Maybe there is. Oh, right. So then there's going to be like a near collision here for some reason. We saw two red lights there on the back of the car, obviously. Approaching blue car, silver car. Can't quite tell there. It's definitely somebody in sunglasses. A little bit interesting. Oh, right, so it takes place at a Sears. And the Sears is marked by a repeated red design element. So now we are going to have another tuning scene, I guess. So, I'm sorry, you know, what was this scene about? The last time we saw that sort of language in this film, it was about, like visual language, you know, it was about Mac contacting his family. But here, he's just kind of hanging out, meditating. And then he looks over at the freeway. I think that really stands out. I don't see any other red vehicles here. But there's just two red cars bunched up there that then kind of stay together. You know, they stay in that grouping. You know, it's not the first time we've seen Mac gazing at a scene that involves that symbol. But yeah, my question would be what's the natural filmic explanation? I use that term often. For that. What is that? I mean, it's a little atmospheric transitional scene. Sure. Yeah, I think it's weird, though. Just think it's weird. That's all I'm saying. Just kidding. That's not all I'm saying. I'm saying very many things. Wait, what? So I believe we're now entering this scene that involves what I previously described as the ghost vacuum. This is a weird, weird scene. I mean, it's an action scene, basically. Let's see if we can't take it like 0.5, though. So this is like a telegraph, but a communication device. What was placed on it? A red cup. So is that going to be like an alarm if Mac grabs this? Is there going to be coke in that? Maybe that's how that works.
Well, you know, it doesn't really matter. So let's talk about it too.
It doesn't really matter. So let's talk about you. Best conversational transition of all time. Okay, there's a sports game on the TV.
What are you doing right now?
Product placement here with coke. TV up here, boombox, phone, legs. So I want to say that's kind of an inverted match a little. Oh, this part, right. Let's say part of an attempt to coax out Mac. But look how Eric makes an offering to this goddess who's reading a book. So I really want to identify her with Sophia. Little offering to Sophia. Perfect. We really linger on that shot. I mean, I know we're watching it in slow motion, but still, there's a feeling of importance on that image. Yeah, with this puppet. It is so ridiculous looking. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 straws? That's right.
Get those cords! Come on! Here's get this vacuum cleaner on your back. We're gonna suck them up.
So I would just like to note, as this is happening, how weirdly we are now recreating structures from Ghostbusters, you know? So that reed with the foam and everything in that first tableau, seeming less and less like an overreed, you know? Now we're strapping vacuums to our back so that we can suck up the weird creature, which we've described twice already in dialogue as a ghost. So it's like the proton packs, you know? It must be, I really think, those sorts of elements must be quite deliberate here. Okay, so first Mac drinks coke from the telegram thing, or whatever it is, ancient communication technology from the dawn of space-time. And then he drinks coke from Sophia, who's reading a book. It's more communication, signal-oriented images. So we're looking at Mac through those horizontally segmented rectangles that compose the closet, and Mac drinking the coke falls on that side. That's amazing that that comes together in the correct way. Let's just do this. Watch it one more time. We do see Mac with the red element very much on that side. Then we see this moving in on that side. And then Debbie combines them in this orientation, which means we have our red over here and our black over here. So I find that pretty matchy in this context. Because they're, you know, they're playing in this thing. They're playing Twin Towers, you know? And so the Ghostbusters. why am I like this? The Ghostbusters are exploding out of the Twin Towers to confront Kali. That's what's happening now in this movie, if you didn't know. Oh, what a weird picture. Bizarre and grotesque. And I love it. I don't understand this. What's happening? What? So just like max ghost energy is motivating this, or I don't understand what's happening. This is the weirdest movie of all time. What is going on? I'm sorry. If there are contents to be noticed here, I'm afraid I cannot notice them right now. This is simply too ridiculous. What is going on now? It's turning into that scene from Nightmare on Elm Street. Also, Ernest goes to jail. That's content. Remarkably. Look at the vacuum. What does that say anyway? Can't quite make it out. Is it just some known vacuum brand, I guess? Look how ghostly, though. You know, it's like his hand is emerging out of that foggy light like a crypt, you know? You see, for me, this film is so goofy. But then it's also actually very authentically creepy to me sometimes. Like, because it's about something else. It is about ghosts, and it's not just about ghosts, probably. It was made in collaboration with them. Okay, well, that's what I'm going to call the analysis for tonight. This is, you know, some kind of becoming aware of the unconscious more directly here. But we're also shining a light on that Coke can. You know, that's because we're looking at a weird product placement thing. But I really think that this weirdness carries extra meaning. So we are now almost halfway through Mac and Me. It's pretty good. Whole lot of ground left to cover. Gosh, I'm tired. All right. Yeah, I'm going to stop talking now. We're going to exit out of full screen, and I'm going to say see you in the future, and I will see you in the future. So bye-bye.